It was late in the day when the word inaugural leapt off the page at me. I was being asked to provide the inaugural St John Ogilvie lecture. Heavens, I thought, that is a privilege and an honour.
So tonight we had the first inaugural St John Ogilvie talk by Father Michael Briody here at the Ogilvie Centre at St Aloysius in Garnet Hill.
St John, or John Ogilvie, was born into a Calvinist family in 1579 or 1580 in Drum near Keith, in the present day district of Moray, in the northeast between Aberdeen and Inverness. At 13 years of age, he was taken to the continent to advance his education so that on his return he could take his place in polite society. He came into contact with the church and was received into it 4 years later. He joined the Jesuits, and after spending a typically lengthy time of preparation in various Jesuit communities in Austria, the present-day Czech Republic and France, he was ordained in Paris in 1610.
He was very good. He knows his historical information, which is great, and he gave a real good feel for the context. Often that's lost, especially the relationship between England and Scotland and the differences that were there, and I think he sketched that very, very well.
Absolutely fantastic to see so many people coming in such an inclement weather night, and it was, you know, I mean, it's fantastic that people, and it was a learning process as well, I believe, that, you know, a lot of people didn't realise the situation that St John Ogilvie found himself in. He's actually been victimised by the king, which I thought was a bit of an eye-opener.
But taking in mind what's here on the board behind me, that he does actually represent that freedom of conscience.
A good turnout of people, excellent talk from Father Briody, not only in the life of John Ogilvie, but putting it into the context of society at that time, and really why again he was such an important saint for religious freedom in his day, but also in our day.
I think his point about freedom of conscience, freedom of religion, in a particular time that we are at the moment, would be no bad thing to have a visible presence of that. His other very good point about not being a kind of jingoistic or triumphalistic, because in one way, Ogilvie is one example of those times where conscience wasn't respected. It still continues today, unfortunately, not necessarily in Britain, but across the world. So I think having a statue that people can remember, as well as being in the churches here, because he's a Catholic, but being outside the Catholic Church and also being a symbol within the city could be excellent.
What are we doing today that will have an effect on people still to be born? In particular, what are we doing now that will have consequences for our fellow Catholics here in Scotland 100 years from now? Hopefully it will be a good effect. What will they think of us? What will they thank us for? What will be our legacy to them?